Amin, lăudat să fie Domnul! Stimată biserică, reocupați-vă locurile, Dumnezeu să lucreze, Dumnezeu să ne binecuvinteze!
Numele meu este Vlad Crâznic și împreună cu Dora, soția mea, vă spunem bine v-am găsit la Chicago! Pentru că coordonez lucrarea lui Dr. Ravi Zacharias în România, anul trecut, în luna mai, am fost gazdă pentru dumnealui în fața 10.000 de oameni la Cluj. După ce am văzut sute de oameni care s-au întors la Dumnezeu în seara aceea, după ce am văzut sute, 1.000 de tineri cântând, am zis la sfârșit, nu cred că în timpul vieții mele voi mai experimenta așa ceva. Asta până în decembrie, când primesc un telefon în drum spre casă seara, nu recunosc numărul, răspund și aud o voce. Pace, frate Vlad, sunt fratele Luigi Mițoi, de la Chicago. Spuneți, frate Luigi. Am văzut ce a făcut fratele Ravi Zacharias în România și am vrea să facem și la Chicago. Anul viitor. Frate Luigi, slabe șanse. Ei bine, Dumnezeu a făcut împotriva credinței mele. Pentru că în seara asta experimentez aici ce am experimentat la Cluj și am spus că nu voi mai experimenta, și anume, 1. Mii de oameni conduși de sute de tineri în închinare. Și ce închinare? 2. Sute de păstori și lucrători care slujesc, fie că sunt văzuți, fie că sunt nevăzuți. Și 3. Prezența lui Ravi Zacharias în mijlocul a mii de români, pentru că iubește românii și România. Dar nu ăsta este singurul motiv pentru care dumnealui este aici, și anume, noi ca și organizație credem și vrem să ajutăm pe gânditor să creadă, asta este apologetica, evanghelizarea, și vrem să ajutăm pe credincios să gândească, tot apologetică, tot evanghelizare, să știm să ne apărăm credința. Atât dumnealui, cât și noi, echipa dumnealui, formată de el, crescută de el, călătorim în întreaga lume și încercăm să ajutăm biserica să-și apere credința și să iasă dintre zidurile ei ca să propovăduiască credința. Prezentarea dumnealui o veți găsi în broșura convenției și nu voi reciti cuvinte de acolo. Emisiunile la radio sunt în toată America, la televizor la fel. La ieșire veți găsi pe dreapta, cum ieșiți, toate cărțile dumnealui traduse în limba română. Nu uitați să vă opriți pe acolo. Și înainte să închei, aș vrea să citesc 3 versete din Fapte 17. Și anume, Pavel, după obiceiul său, a intrat în sinagogă. 3 zile de sabat a vorbit cu ei din Scripturi, dovedind și lămurind că Hristos trebuia să pătimească și să învie din morți. Și acest Iisus pe care vi-l vestesc eu, zicea el, este Hristosul. Unii din ei și o mare mulțime de greci temători de Dumnezeu și multe femei de frunte au crezut și au trecut de partea lui Pavel și a lui Sila. Când mă gândesc la Ravi Zacharias, mă gândesc la un om care calcă pe urmele Domnului Iisus, și a făcut din Pavel un model. De ce? Pentru că din propovăduirea și apărarea credinței creștine a făcut un obicei. Pavel după obiceiul său. Și doi, o face dovedind și lămurind. În engleză cuvântul este reasoning. Cine altcineva să o facă mai bine decât un om ales de Dumnezeu. Și în seara asta îl invit în fața noastră pe Ravi Zacharias. Please be welcome.
Well, good evening to you all. I'm sorry to be spoiling such a wonderful spirit of worship. You're all enjoying your singing. I don't know why you have to listen to my voice now, because at home even our dog starts barking when I sing. So I try not to sing too much when I'm on the road and save my voice for speaking. When David McDoot and the others had met me at Moody earlier on in the year and asked me to come and speak today, I was convinced to be impossible. And then when I looked at my diary, I said, that's amazing, this weekend is free. I said, how did that happen? So I accepted it, and a month ago I found out why it was free. Tonight is my granddaughter's third birthday party. And when I looked at that, I said, what have I done? I'm going to be in trouble. I'll be evicted from my family. I'll have to stay on in Chicago for a long time. My family is in Atlanta. So I looked at my wife. I said, how did this happen? And her actual birthday is on Monday. And my assistant had circled the Monday for the party. But I did not know that everybody had been invited tonight. So I talked to my daughter and asked her if it's okay. And she gave me her blessing. My wife gave me her blessing. So I spoke to the family today. And you pray that the home will still be open to me when I return tomorrow to celebrate her birthday on Monday night. But thank you for having me. It's wonderful to be here. And what Vlad was saying about the memorable meetings in Cluj some time ago, it was an amazing evening to just hear that thousand voice choir that he talked about and to see the hundreds of people coming to know the Lord. See, it was about in the 70s, that late 70s, that I went to Romania for the first time. I was in the city of Pitești. It was somewhere or just a little after I think Billy Graham had been there. And I heard a story told by Billy Graham. It was an amazing story that two of the pilots that had flown him into Romania were walking the streets of Bucharest on a cold winter's day. Everybody was bundled up and walking through the streets, and they saw a man walking by on the sidewalk whistling a tune, and it was a very rare hymn, "My the Great Physician Now Is Here, the Sympathizing Jesus." So the two pilots who were Christians couldn't believe that here in the streets of Romania they were seeing a Romanian man whistling a hymn. So they locked step with him, walked beside him, and whistled with him the same tune. And he stopped, looked at them, but since they couldn't speak each other's language, he pointed to the heavens, touched his heart, they embraced each other, and said goodbye. I told that story some years ago after having heard it from Billy Graham, and there was a lady in the audience in New York when I spoke. She said, "You're talking about my husband." He was that pilot walking through the streets of Bucharest and hearing this man whistling that beautiful hymn. So I said at that time, I've got to get to this country. I've got to be there, which God made it possible many times. And then recently with my colleague Vlad now setting up office there. So you all represent one of my favorite countries in the world. And I want to thank you for your witness, for your hospitality. And I hope before my life ends on this earth, I can get back there a few more times. You can't beat the hospitality there. I've been to, of course, to Pitești, to Bucharest, to Cluj, to Timișoara, and also to Sinaia. And I just look forward to getting back and eating some more of that wonderful pork that you serve there at every meal. You come back quite pork full by the time you're finished. You know, it was great to hear the choir singing "Joshua Fit the Battle of Jericho." The story is told of the Sunday school teacher who was checking out the religious knowledge of his children and how the instruction was being done at home. So she said, "Who pulled down the walls of Jericho?" And she looked at the little boy, and Johnny, she said, "What's your answer?" He said, "I promise you, teacher, I didn't do it." She was so shocked that he'd never heard the story, so the next day she went to visit the family. And she saw the mother there. She said, "You know, I'm astounded. This famous story of Joshua and the Battle of Jericho and the walls coming down. Yesterday, when I asked the class, who pulled down the walls of Jericho, your son Johnny said, 'I promise you, teacher, I didn't do it.'" And the mother said, "I want to tell you something about my Johnny. If he says he didn't do it, he really didn't do it." Now he was really astounded and decided to go and visit the father at the office. So he went to the office and said, "You know what's happened? Your son says this, your wife said that. The father said, I've heard about you. What's the problem? How much did this wall cost anyway? We'll try and replace it." Biblical knowledge, so rare, so unknown in our time. We are a biblically illiterate people. So little of the scripture is expounded. And as I've been asked to speak to you on the maturing and the instructing of the church, I want to talk to you about that a little bit. But let me tell you a funny little story before that. This young man was being interviewed for ordination, and the bishop said to him, "Do you know the story of the Good Samaritan?" And he said, yes, sir, I do. He said, tell me the story. So the man says, it's a story about this man who was traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among the thorns, and the thorns sprang up and choked him. And as he went on, he didn't have any money. And he met the Queen of Sheba, and she gave him 1,000 talents of gold and 100 changes of raiment. And he got into a chariot and drove furiously. And when he was driving under a big juniper tree, his hair got caught in the limb of that tree, and he hung there many days, and the ravens brought him food to eat and water to drink, and he ate 5,000 loaves of bread and 2 fishes. One night when he was hanging there asleep, his wife Delilah came along and cut off his hair, and he dropped and fell on stony ground. But he got up and went on and began to rain, and it rained 40 days and 40 nights, and he hid himself in a cave and lived on locusts and wild honey. Then he went on till he met a servant who said, come take supper at my house. And he made an excuse and said, no, I've married a wife and I can't go. The servant went out to the highways and the hedges and compelled him to come in. After supper, he went on and came down to Jericho. And when he got there, he looked up and saw that old Queen Jezebel sitting up on the high in the window. And she laughed at him. And he said, throw her down. Then they picked her up and he said, throw her down again. And then they threw her down 70 times 7. And of the fragments that remained, they picked up 12 baskets full besides women and children. They said, blessed are the peacemakers, P-I-E-C-E. Now, whose wife do you think she will be on that judgment day? You know what? The day will come where an audience in the church will not so sure understand how messed up that story is. He's put together scores of biblical narratives and messed up the story of the Good Samaritan. How do you and I mature? How do we grow? How does the church engage some of the brightest and keenest minds in our world today? My colleagues and I go to some of the finest universities in the world, whether you're at Harvard or Princeton or Yale, whether you're at MIT, whether you're at the universities of India or the universities of Europe, the audiences are packed to capacity, and the young men and women are coming there because they have no answers to life's deepest questions. All the peripheral issues are addressed in our churches. Sometimes we don't get to the depth of what it is people really want to know. And the same has happened in the university. If the church doesn't rise up to the occasion and see this vacuum and see the emptiness and minister to the souls of people and understand the depths of their longing, we will make the same mistake that our universities have made. All of the disciplines, all of the subjects, and they've left the souls of their young men and women empty. In fact, a powerful book written by one of the professors at Yale recently says that secularism has failed this generation and they do not have any answers. So I say, has the church given the answers? Are we taking the opportunity to listen to the questions of our young? They are longing to put together the answers to life's deepest questions. There are 4 of them. The question of origin, the question of meaning, the question of morality, and the question of destiny. Origin, meaning, morality, and destiny. The scriptures is the only source that gives us the answers. Listen to me carefully now. Answers that are individually and correspondingly true. And when all of the answers are given, there is a coherence to those answers so that life can be put back together again, rather than leaving us a fragmented individual. The very English word individual means we are indivisible. We cannot be fragmented. We are looking for coherence and meaning. This is a moment for the church to rise up as a mature body of men and women and instruct in such a way so that the deepest questions are answered for humanity. There are no other answers anywhere else, believe me. I want to speak to you tonight from 2 Kings 21 and 22. It's the story of two kings, Manasseh and Josiah. And my message is entitled, Lessons from History, The Tale of Two Men. The famed poet Percy Bysshe Shelley wrote this poem. I'm sure you as a people can relate to it. It's a bit difficult to interpret and translate, but the general idea will be communicated to you. Shelley wrote this, I met a traveler from an antique land who said to vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert. Near them on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that the sculptor well those passions read, the hand that mocked them and the heart that fed, stamped on these lifeless things. And on the pedestal these words appear, my name is Ozymandias, King of Kings, look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Nothing beside remains round that colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away. Demagogues, dictators, whose statues lie in deserts half shattered, with broken countenances, and words written to exalt them, only to find out that through history they have come crashing down and stand in some lonely terrain somewhere with a frown and wrinkled lip and a sneer of cold command that the sculptor read, but the lone and level sands stretch far away to talk about the demagoguery that comes and goes. You as a nation have lived through that kind of struggle, with a demagogue having come and gone and inflicted the kind of pain that he did on millions of people for so many years, and yet there were men whistling hymns on the streets of Bucharest. And yet, today you are here by the thousands. You see, Jesus Christ always rises up to outlive his pallbearers. Those who think they are carrying him to their grave, to his grave, find out he has triumphed over the grave and his word abides forever. So I want to thank you for your faith, for your commitment, and I want to focus my message particularly on this younger generation, because they will have to carry the torch. They will have to carry the light into the future. History is really a collection, said somebody, of innumerable biographies. History is a collection of innumerable biographies. When you and I live, we paint a self-portrait of our lives on the canvas of time. When you get to eternity and look through the keyhole of eternity, you will take a look at the whole gallery of paintings and the whole gallery of biographies. It's your turn and my turn. Let's take a look at these two kings and see what happened and the results of that. First is the king Manasseh. The Bible says he was 12 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 55 years. His mother's name was Hephzibah. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord, following the detestable practices of the nations the Lord had driven out before the Israelites. He rebuilt the high places his father Hezekiah had destroyed. He also erected altars to Baal and made an Asherah pole, as Ahab, king of Israel, had done. He bowed down to all the starry hosts and worshipped them. He built altars in the temple of the Lord, of which the Lord had said, in Jerusalem, I will put my name. In both courts of the temple of the Lord, he built altars to all the starry hosts. He sacrificed his own son in the fire as he practiced sorcery, divination, and consulted mediums and spiritists. He did much evil in the eyes of the Lord, provoking him to anger. You see what he did? Longest reigning monarch, 55 years, but he provoked the Lord to anger and did evil in the eyes of the Lord, including offering his son to the burning arms of an idol, as screams would go out towards the heavens of mothers calling for help and calling for protection. He made three choices. You see, his father's name was Hezekiah. Hezekiah had brought in a reformation into that land, a revival in that land. When Manasseh came on the scene, he decided to turn his back upon the God that his father had worshipped, to turn his back upon the revival that had come in, and he clenched his fist towards the heavens and decided he was going to make decisions that would turn the whole nation away from following God. That was the first choice he made. There was a second choice he made. He turned them towards all kinds of idolatrous beliefs. Young people, listen to me. You cannot live for long under the illusion of neutrality. You will never be neutral. If you turn your back upon the living God, you will have to find some false gods and false altars and false places to worship. Nature abhors a vacuum. And when we turn our back upon the living God, we start following incredible philosophies and ideas. As G.K. Chesterton said, the tragedy of disbelieving in God is not that we end up believing nothing. It is much worse than that. We may end up believing in anything. Think of all that has happened in our time. The definitions we have lost. This is the first generation in 5,000 years that doesn't even know how to define the basic realities of what it means to be human and how we relate to each other. You know what I'm talking about. The struggle to define good and evil, right from wrong, and we've clenched our fist towards the heavens. Ironically, many of you left your homeland to come here for the freedom to worship, and now that very freedom is threatened even here. When you turn your back upon the living God, you end up living towards hostile beliefs. And the third thing he did, he started a bitter persecution of the prophets. Logically, it follows. You turn your back upon God, you erect false altars, and you try to silence those who are calling you back to God. In fact, Isaiah was murdered by Manasseh. The Bible in the book of Hebrews tells us some of them were sawn asunder. Isaiah was that man it is talking about. He was the prophet who spoke of the virgin birth, who spoke of the suffering servant and the Messiah who was going to be wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities. Manasseh pursued him to silence him. He hid inside the hollow trunk of a tree. When they found him, Manasseh ordered that tree trunk sawn in two. The Bible mentions that in the book of Hebrews. This was Manasseh's desire to silence people who speak for the truth. You know, it's fascinating today. You go into our university campuses. I have never heard a professor mock Islam. They're intellectual cowards. You'll never see them mocking any pantheistic worldview. But my, oh my, oh my, do they ever mock the Christian faith? Do they ever ridicule the Christian faith? Books are written on it. Lectures are given on it. I've seen it happen again and again and again. They can laugh at the Bible. They can mock the Bible. They can mock the Christian. They had dare not do that with the scriptures of any other worldview. They don't even have the courage to be consistent in what it is they do. When you turn your back upon God and follow false gods, three things happen after you persecute the voices of those who want to speak the truth. Number one, you find out it is possible for one person to lead millions into untold evil. It's possible in history for one person, to lead millions into untold evil. Take a look at just one life, Joseph Stalin. Once upon a time, he was a seminary student preparing to go into the ministry. He turned his back upon God. In fact, the last thing that Joseph Stalin did in his action, his daughter Svetlana was standing by his bedside. He'd already executed 15 million of his own people. 15 million of them. He's not a very big man. The last gesture that Stalin did, Malcolm Muggeridge, the British journalist, noticed it. Paul Johnson, the historian, has documented it. Svetlana Stalin, his daughter, testified to it. She was standing by the side of her father's bedside. He was waving away the wolves, he said. He was hallucinating. But the last gesture was to sit up in bed, clench his fist towards the heavens, throw his head back on the pillow, and he was gone. One man caused the death of millions and led a whole nation into such darkness. When I had the privilege of speaking at the Lenin Military Academy some years ago and the Center for Geopolitical Strategy in Moscow, my wife was sitting on my right and on my left, my colleague. I had 3 hours with the faculty at the Center for Geopolitical Strategy. At the Lenin Military Academy, one of them is giving me the choke sign to stop. I just look in a different direction and keep going. So here we were at the Center for Geopolitical Strategy, 8 stories above ground, 4 stories below ground. The entire faculty was atheistic, entire faculty. I was sitting at the front with the table, my wife on one side, my colleague on the other, and they were throwing questions after me, one after another, grim, angry men as atheists. Finally, I shared a story. I said, you know what? Your man, Stalin, years ago, when he was killing you by the millions, a diplomat came to visit him. And she looked at him and said, how long are you planning to keep doing this and still expect your people to follow you? He didn't say anything. He called a waiter to bring a live chicken. He brought the live chicken and he started to defeather that chicken and denuded it completely. He put the chicken on the ground and moved towards the back, and the chicken, trembling and quivering, rushed towards him and nuzzled between his trouser legs. He had a piece of bread in his hand and he bent down and the chicken started pecking away at the bread. Stalin said, do you have your answer? I have tortured that chicken. It will follow me for food the rest of its life. People are like that chicken. You torture them and they will follow you for food the rest of their lives. As I was leaving, they lined up. And my wife went first, and they had calmed down. They had really calmed down. They kissed the back of her hand. And then my turn came, and the head of the entire institution gripped my hand, and he said, Mr. Zacharias, what you have told us today about God and about history is true, but it's very difficult to change after 70 years of believing a lie. Shared the same story with the general, half of it in the session, half of it in the dining room. My wife was sitting next to me, and the general who had invited me there, when he was eating his food, started to quiver at the lips. He started to tremble, and I could see his eyes were flooded with tears. I had the privilege of praying with that general and seeing him come to Jesus Christ. Very difficult to change after 70 years of believing a lie. It's possible for one person to lead millions into untold evil. Go to Auschwitz today in Poland, where I have been, where they were obliterating them at the rate of 12,000 every day. And what Hitler wrote is on the walls outside the gas ovens. I want to raise a generation of young people devoid of a conscience, imperious, relentless, and cruel. I want to raise a whole generation of young people devoid of a conscience, imperious, relentless, and cruel. One person can change history and take all of mankind in a wrong-headed direction. But the reason that one person can do it is a second deduction, because most people don't know how to think anymore. Have you seen the illogic of people today? How irrational we are, how illogical we have become. We want 10-second answers to the most important questions in life. If you can't say it in 40 words, they're not interested in reading about it. How are we going to think? How are we going to think? We have to learn to think rationally, reasonably, or we become irrational. and destructive. I was speaking at the University of Iowa, and after I'd spoken on the subject of man's search for meaning, a young student went up. The place was packed, 1,500 students and faculty there. This woman ran up to the microphone, put her hands like this and said, "Who ever told you that life needed to be coherent? Where did you get this?" She said, "Have you been so influenced by the West that we need to have coherence?" And you know, I've learned if you allow any person to talk long enough, they will convict themselves. So I let her keep talking. And then finally, when she stopped, I said, "Madam, I hear you. I'll be glad to answer you if you will answer just one question of mine. When I answer you, do you want my answer to be coherent or can my answer be incoherent?" And the audience just burst out laughing. I said, no, don't laugh. I want her to answer my question. Is it okay for my answer to be incoherent? You see, we are teaching people to demand coherence of the opponents, but we can be incoherent ourselves. University of Philippines, Manila, years ago, I'd spoken again on man's search for meaning. A fellow went to the microphone and said, "I don't believe this." He said, "Everything in life is meaningless." I said, "You don't believe that?" He said, "I do believe it. Everything is meaningless." I said, "You don't believe that?" He said, "Who are you to tell me I don't believe it?" I said, "Say it one more time." He said, "Everything in life is meaningless." I said, "You don't believe that?" He was mad by now. So I said, "Listen to me carefully. If everything in life is meaningless, what you just said was meaningless too. In other words, if what you're saying is true, what you have actually said is nonsense. That everything in life is meaningless, and therefore what you've just said is meaningless too. On the other hand, if life is meaningful and your statement is meaningful, then everything in the world is not meaningless." The audience started applauding. So at the end of the meeting, I was walking out and I saw this guy walking at the back of the room going, "If everything is meaningless, then what I just said was not meaningful either." He couldn't figure out that what he was saying, he attempted to be meaningful, but he'd actually destroyed meaning completely. He came to the public meeting that night in Manila, gave his life to Jesus Christ to find the real meaning and the real purpose of life. See, you have to learn to think. And we live with a generation that listens with its eyes and thinks with its feelings. We have to learn to read. We have to teach our children to read. They have to understand sequential thought. It's not 15-second sound bites. The greatest gift God gave to us apart from the dwelling of the Holy Spirit is the written word of God, and the word of God abides forever. Amen. You see, the Bible doesn't say in the beginning was video. It says in the beginning was the word, and truth is primarily a property of language and propositions. Number one, one can lead millions into untold evil. Number two, the reason they can lead millions into untold evil is because most people don't know how to think anymore. Just think of where we are in the United States. Look at where we are in the election process. And we may look at the two candidates and wonder what we're really choosing from. But who chose them? The people. How can we cast stones on a candidate we say we don't trust when we voted for the candidate? It's amazing. It's amazing. No one would ever have dreamed that we would come to a time in Western civilization where everything that we have ever believed is being tossed into the winds, and we don't even consider character and integrity of any importance anymore. It's a sad day. And so the last result of what Manasseh did the ultimate test of any civilization, is what we do with our children. The ultimate test of any civilization is what we do with our children. If you read a commentator describing what Manasseh did, nighttime seems to have been the special time for these awful immolations. The yells of the children bound to the altars or rolling into the fire from the brazen arms of the idol. The shouts and hymns of the frantic crowds and the wild tumult of drums and shrill instruments by which the cries of the victims were sought to be drowned. It rose an awful discordance over the city, forming with the whole scene visible from the walls by the glow of the furnaces and flames such an ideal of transcendent horror that the name of the valley became then and still continues in Jerusalem to this very day, the Valley of Hinnom, which comes from the word Gehenna, the usual word for hell. If you go to Jerusalem today, you will walk through the Valley of Hinnom. It comes from the word Gehenna, hell. It got that name from Manasseh's day when he offered children into the arms of the idols and the drums would drown it and the flames and the amber-colored sky and the screams of children and parents watching what was happening as Manasseh had ordered it. People looking at it said, this is what hell must be like, and they called it the Valley of Hinnom, Gehenna. 2.5 millennia have gone by. That name still remains because of what they did with their children. You know, I have 4 grandchildren. The oldest is 5. His name is Jude. He's a smart little boy. I don't know where he gets his linguistic skills from, but he uses very big words, honestly. One day we are having dinner at his place and he says to me, Papa, what is the meaning of sophomoric? The boy wasn't even 5, wanting to know. I couldn't pronounce that many syllables when I was his age. What is the meaning of sophomoric? When he was 3.5, his mother, Naomi, my daughter, had lost her car keys in the house, and she couldn't find it. She stopped, she slapped her forehead and said, I must be losing my mind. And this little boy comes and stands in front of her and said, Mommy, whatever you do, please don't ever lose your heart because I'm in there. Mommy, whatever you do, please don't ever lose your heart because I am in there. The Bible says, out of the mouths of children and babes, you have ordained praise. What we do with our children is the ultimate test of any civilization. Take a look at what we are doing to the children of the world today. One man in Sidon I was introduced to, every morning he brings his 10-year-old son to look across the border and he tells his son these words every morning. Whatever you do in life, your goal in life should be to kill as many people on the other side as you can. It's a 10-year-old boy listening to his father tell him that. Look at how we raise our kids. Some of the stuff they watch on television, some of the pornography they're getting into at ages 12, 13, 14. How incredible is this that we take little minds and ruin them and plant ideas in those sensitive little souls till they ruin their youth years, they ruin their marital years, and they look back in the middle years in life and say, what have I done that no human being can satisfy me anymore? Ladies and gentlemen, to you young people, I caution you, the world doesn't really care about the coherence of who you are. They don't really care as long as they can be enriched at your expense. And what God does is send his only begotten Son for you and to me to rescue us from ourselves and to bring about that change within our heart. What Manasseh did was destroy his whole nation because people didn't know how to think, and he spent away the next generation at his own whim. Do you know what's the irony of Manasseh's life? He repented later on in life, but by this point a whole generation or two had been lost. His son came on the scene, lasted about 2 months. His grandson came on the scene, his name is Josiah, Let me just read two or three verses. Josiah was 8 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 31 years. His mother's name was Jedidah, daughter of Adiah. She was from Bozkath. He did what was right in the eyes of the Lord and walked in all the ways of his father David, not turning aside to the right or to the left. Josiah comes in at age 8. And if you read the biography of this man, it is incredible. At age 16, he started to seek after God. At age 20, he started to cleanse Jerusalem. At age 26, he started to cleanse the temple and found that the word of God that had been lost right into the in the temple. And they found the book of the law in the house of the Lord. Age 8, king. Age 16, child of God. Age 20, cleansing a city. Age 26, cleansing the temple and discovers the book of the law. He did two things for his people. Number one, he gave them back the word of God. You and I will never grow. We will never grow deeper and deeper and deeper until this becomes the centerpiece of our life. Thy word is truth. The word abides forever, ever. It's like the bright sun that gets brighter and brighter and brighter till the full high noon of day. And I say to you and I ask you, what role has the word of God played in your life? What is it playing in your life? When I turned 50 years old, about 2,000 years ago, my wife said to me, what would you like for your birthday? I said, you know what, honey? I really don't need anything. I said, but I think back upon my youth. My dad used to take me to church. I cannot give you a single sermon that I heard. I never listened to a word of what the vicar had to say because I was dreaming of playing cricket matches later on in the day. And at the age of 17, I tried to take my own life. I was in a hospital room trying suicide. And the doctor gave me no more than 4 or 5 days to live. My body was dehydrated. I'd spit out all the poison and the moisture was gone. They had needles inside me. My mother by my bedside, sobbing her heart out. My father embarrassed what he was going to tell the people. He was a big man in the Indian government. A man walked into my room and he had a Bible in his hand. And he told my mother, I want to read it to your son. She said, I don't even know how you got here. My son is dying. He said, that's right, ma'am. He needs this more than anything else. She said, I can't let you stay. So he opened the word of God to John 14 and had her read it to me. My mother's English was not that good. She was reading from the King James language. And she comes to the words in John 14, 19, Jesus says to Thomas, because I live, you also shall live. I didn't understand anything except this. I didn't know how to live. I didn't know how to live. I didn't know why to live. And Jesus said, because I live, you also shall live. I said, Jesus, whoever you are, because of your life, I might live again. Change my heart. Change my heart and take me out of here. 5 days later, I walked out of there whole and healthy. So when my wife said, what do you want for your birthday? You know, I said, honey, I would love to get an old Anglican prayer bench. I would love to begin my day on my knees every day that I'm home. Can you find an Anglican prayer bench somewhere where I can place a Bible and a hymn book and begin my day on my knees every day before the Lord? My wife's an amazing woman. She searched around the globe, found one, and it arrived for my 50th birthday. It's downstairs in my study, beside my desk. I guard it as the sacred spot where I meet my God on my knees every day with the Word of God and a hymn book that gets into my soul every morning. Can I ask you, if you make any decision tonight, make one, that you will begin every day on your knees before God. You know, as a traveling man, it's hard. I travel over 200 days a year. But I have to find a spot. I have to find a place. And I have to pour my mind into that word of God. It is truly the bread that God has given to you and to me. And so I say to you, when Josiah gave people the word of God, they heard it and they humbled themselves and cried out to him. It pierced them into their hearts. When I read the word of God for the first time, I couldn't even hold it. My body was dehydrated. I couldn't hold the Bible. And as my mother's holding it with her hands trembling, and I prayed that prayer at age 17, which began the conversion of one member of my family after another. Till the day when I was getting my first honorary doctorate from Houghton College in New York, my father was sitting in the front, and there were tears running down his face. Tears running down his face. And he came to me afterwards and said, "Son, I never dreamed. I never dreamed of the day what God would do in your life when I called you a loser and one who was going to bring shame to the family. I'm ashamed of myself for anything that I didn't see." You know. The word, the church needs it. The world needs it. I encourage your pastors to bury themselves in the word and expound it to the people. We need it as the word from God and as the bread of life. Let me tell you a quick story. I was in Lebanon some years ago in Beirut, and my host was a man by the name of Sammy Dagger. Sammy Dagger is not very big, but when he wishes you good morning in Arabic, he puts more energy into good morning than most people would put into a sermon. "How are you?" He raises his hand and shouts out, you know. He knows no fear. On the back of his van is the bumper sticker, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." And he goes through all of the Muslim territories with the bumper sticker on the back of his van. So we were driving in his van, which moved more by faith than it did by anything under the hood. So we're driving, and there's a whole lot of Syrian soldiers who put their arms up and stop us. And they ask us to pull over onto the side and roll our windows down. And there's a barrel of a gun on his side and a barrel of the gun on my side. I said, "What have I done? Why did I trust this man to take me where I am going? I'm finished." So they look at him and say, "Do you have any dynamite?" He says, "Yes." "This van is full of dynamite." And he's translating and telling me that. They're asking me, "Brother Rafi, if I have any dynamite." I have just told them, "This van is full of dynamite." I said, "Sammy, what are you doing?" And then he puts his hand out. There's a tarp over the van. And he's rummaging around. And they're watching him, the barrel of the gun now, both of us, you know. And he pulls out a New Testament. And he gives it to the Syrian soldier. He said, "This is the dynamite I'm talking about. It's not the kind that will hurt." The Syrian soldier was fed up with him. So he looks at me and he says, "Hindu," which is Arabic for Indian. At this point, I was willing to say yes to anything. I said, "Ha ha, see, I'm from India." He steps back, salutes me and says, "Indira Gandhi Mubarak," which means "Give my greetings to Indira Gandhi." I said, "I'll be honored to do it." And he, as if I played marbles with Indira Gandhi, you know, I said, "I'll be happy to take your greetings to Indira Gandhi anytime." So they pulled the barrel of the gun back, said, "Just drive on." So Sammy moves, chugs along for about 20 yards, and he pulls over. I said, "Sammy, don't stop. Just keep going. Just keep going." He said, "Brother Ravi, let me tell you something. For years, I would get on my knees and I would be asking God to open the doors for Syria, because no missionaries are allowed in Syria. And I was so upset that God was not answering my prayer." He said, "And when I saw 50,000 Syrian soldiers come into Beirut and to Lebanon, I got on my knees and got angry with God. I said, 'What are you doing to my country? You're bringing 50,000 Syrian soldiers into Lebanon.'" He said, "I felt God saying to me, 'Sammy, for all these years, you complained that Syria doesn't allow any missionaries in there. So I'm sending 50,000 Syrians to you, and you're still complaining to me.'" And you know what? Time is running out. I could tell you, he never ever stops giving the word of God to everyone wherever he sees them. He carries these New Testaments in his van. He opens conversations. What a beautiful gift to give people God's word. It changed my heart in a simple little reading. I know it has changed yours too. But the second thing Josiah did, not only did he give them the word, he taught them how to worship. What does it mean to really worship? What does it mean to really worship? It means to pull together all of your faculties in the greatest expression for which you and I are created. Your thoughts, your heart, your feelings, your emotions, your will, all of this coming together in the greatest expression of which you are capable. Worship of the living God. A great philosopher said there are two great days in your life. One is the day that you are born, and the second is the day when you find out why. One is the day that you were born, and the second is when you find out why. Do you know why you were created? You were created to worship the living God. That's what it is all about. Worship is the submission of all of our nature to God, said Archbishop William Temple. It is the bringing of our conscience, our mind, our heart, our will. All of that in adoration brings you before God. You see, every other worldview goes to the temple or the place of worship. You and I don't go to the temple. We take the temple with us. He dwells in this body of yours and mine. What a beautiful gift God's given to you and me, the word and worship. Three things happen. Number one, he brought them to dwell in the conviction of safety. Safety. They were safe again. I was preaching in Seoul, Korea last week. One of my friends from Seoul, Billy Kim, tells the story. During the Korean War, an American soldier was in his shell hole and his mates were being slaughtered. And he was commanded to go out and rescue his fallen mates. And he said he would do it, but he would hunker down with fear as the bullets were flying. And the commanding officer said, "I told you to go and rescue your mates." He said, "Yes, sir, I'll do it." But he kept looking at his watch, and he wouldn't go. Finally, all of a sudden, he looked at his watch and jumped out of the shell hole and started to rescue his fallen mates. After that horrific night, at dawn, somebody looked at him and said, "What on earth were you doing? You were commanded to go and rescue your mates, and you kept looking at your watch." He said, "I want to tell you something. I don't know God. I didn't know God, but my mother does. And I remember my mother telling me what hour of each day she was going to be praying for me. And I was waiting for that hour to strike when I knew under the prayers of my mother, I need not be afraid of any bullets or any shells flying in any directions. The prayer of a godly parent can inspire such rest and such peace and such comfort. Even in a young life, with all of the firepower at their beckoning, they still trust more in the prayers of a godly mother or a godly father. It brings you to safety. Number two, gives you the power to change, just the power to change. Let me give you one simple illustration and close with my final thought. My colleagues and I have the privilege of going to Angola prison in Louisiana every now and then. It was the most deadly prison in America. Over 5,000 prisoners there, over 5,000, and 85% of them are on life without parole. Nearly 50 of them are on death row. The first time I went there, I was amazed at what was going on in that prison. You see, we were told that when prisoners were brought in, they were given a knife to protect themselves. Because there's blood on the ceiling, blood on the floor, blood on the walls. It was a rough and tumble type of place. But one man came in as the warden, and he said, "Let me do this my way." He opened a chapel there and had daily worship. He started Bible studies, brought in a theological seminary, and gangs of thugs were changed into gangs of pastors. The life was changed. You walk in through death row, and you see those on death row with the Bible open before them, or reading books by John Piper, reading theological volumes. Last time I went, one guy was doing his PhD in some theological theme. When I finished preaching at one service, there was a young man who was leading in worship, and I said to him, "Are you here on Life Without Parole?" He said, "Yes, sir." I said, "Can I ask you a question?" He said, "Yes." I said, "How do you feel about it? You're never going to get out of here. You're still so young. You're never going to get out of here." He said, "Mr. Zacharias, if you knew why I was here, you would never really ask me that question. But once I came here, I found Jesus Christ, who changed my heart. For the first time in my life, I am really free." He said, "Pray for my parents who think they are free, but they are actually in prison outside." What a transformation of the human heart. It has become this one of the safest prisons in the country because of the Word of God and the example of what worship is all about. And so it brings you to safety, changes your heart, and lastly, it rescues you from the tyranny of the immediate. It rescues you from the tyranny of the immediate. We all live with fear for the moment. We would all like to see changes immediately. But God in his sovereign will moves and moves. I have no idea what direction we will be taking by the end of this year. I have no idea. But I have one certainty. No matter what happens, we can dwell safely under the arms of God and under the umbrella of God. And so, as I close, I bring to you a statement by King George VI in 1939. The world was on the brink of a terrible war, and he had a stuttering problem. His daughter, the present queen, was 12 years old. She put a piece of paper into her father's hand. She said, "Father, this is what the world needs to hear from you." She was 12. And so he gives his speech and gives the words that she had found to give to him. Here are the words. A 12-year-old girl gave it to her father. "I said to the man at the gate of the year, 'Give me a light that I may walk safely into the unknown.' And he said to me, 'Go out into the darkness and put your hand into the hand of God. It shall be to you better than the light and safer than the known.' I said to the man at the gate of the year, 'Give me a light that I may walk safely into the unknown.' He said to me, 'Go out into the darkness and put your hand into the hand of God. It shall be to you better than the light and safer than the known." Manasseh made those choices, brought the consequences. Josiah made the choices, the word and worship, and brought the consequences of safety, a transformed heart, and being rescued from the tyranny of the immediate. Will you put your hand into God's hand tonight? Amen. Will you do that? Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to ask you to stand with me in prayer, and I'm going to ask the musicians to play. Here's what I want you to do. If God has spoken to you tonight and you say, "Ravi, I need to put my hand into the hand of God. I need to make a commitment to start worshiping in spirit and in truth. I need to read his word." Or you may say, "I've never really known him. I need to do that tonight." If God has spoken to you, don't wait for anybody else. As the musicians play, just step out from where you are and come and stand in the front here or in the aisles. I would love to pray for you as you make that decision. This could be the turning moment of life for you and your family as you bring your heart in total surrender to him. Would you step out right now? Don't wait for anybody else. Come right to the front, and I will pray for you as you come. God bless you. There you are, people coming. Keep coming. from upstairs down, please come. Please come. If God has spoken to you, and you know you need to make this the moment of commitment. Upstairs as well. We'll wait for you. Maybe you're wandering very far off and you say, Ravi, my heart is so cold. I've really turned my back upon him. You may be in a relationship that is wrong. You may have made choices that are really hurting you. And tonight you want to say, I want to change. I want to give my heart back to God and want him to work and change my heart and bring me to himself. This is the moment. Please come. Wait a moment or two more. Don't wait for others. Ask God to give you the strength. Say, please help me as I go up front. Please come. I can talk especially to one group, I would talk to the men, and especially to the young men. This world would be a much better place if men really followed God the way God expects them to, and if young men were fearless in their commitment to Jesus Christ. So you're a young man, an older man, and you know you're struggling in your walk. Why don't you make this the night that you make the turn? Say, Lord, help me. I need to get up there. I need to be the example in my home. I need to do what you want me to do. Why don't you come? Make this that moment. Wherever you are, sir, young man, you come. God bless you. God bless you. As others are coming, let me pray. Father, I know that deep in our hearts, we ache so much. We've missed out on so much. We need you. I pray for our nation that you will turn the hearts of leaders towards you. I thank you for the miracle you brought in Romania, giving people the privilege to believe. And yet, Lord, things are tough there. That nation needs you. Thank you for the men and women from that great land, for the church here, the Romanian church in America. I thank you for the pastors here, that they will have their hearts warmed tonight towards you. I pray your blessing upon every one of us, and we pause for a few moments just to talk to you. Please hear our prayer, Father, as we speak to you. We are grateful, dear God. May your blessing abide upon this community. May their greatest days still be ahead. thank you for the honor you've given me of ministering here tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to thank you for giving me a hearing. I want to thank my brother Vlad for the work he's doing with us in your great country, and Pastor David for working with me coming here. May God richly bless you. And if you need to stay here to pray with the pastor, do that, but settle whatever God brought you forward for and seal that with a commitment. May God richly bless you. Thank you. Amen.